Hello everybody, Captain Max here, and today we're going to talk about the making of the 1969 classic movie, The Battle of Britain. This movie rivals Tora 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 for being one of the most in-depth and large-scale movies ever made that involve military aviation. The movie was made in 1968. It was filmed largely in England, in Spain, and in the Mediterranean. A man named Benjamin C. Fizz, who had flown Hurricanes in World War II, was going to make a movie about Ord Wingate, but the Wingate family pulled out of the deal at the last minute, leaving him with funding but no movie to make. It just so happened, as he was pondering his future, that a Hawker Hurricane and a Supermarine Spitfire that were practicing for the annual historic flypast flew overhead. This gave him the idea. What about the greatest battle to take place over the English skies, the Battle of Britain? Fizz took the idea and ran with it. There's an excellent book by Leonard Mosely called The Battle of Britain about the making of the movie. The book was printed in 1970, only a year after the movie was made. It is the primary resource I used for the research on this subject. A British movie making group called the Rank Organization initially approved the project, but it turned out to be more expensive than anyone thought. Getting the script written was a huge problem, not to mention how to go about it. Having been a World War II veteran himself, one of the things that Fizz wanted to do was to prevent the movie from becoming a piece of British propaganda. The Battle of Britain marks the first time that both sides of World War II are represented evenly. It's also one of the first movies where they use German actors speaking native German with English subtitles. They also use German technical advisors to make sure they got the German side of the story correct. This helped to avoid the movie from becoming a propaganda piece. Amongst the many technical advisors they have that were veterans of the conflict, to represent the German side, they had none other than German ace Adolf Galland, and for the British side, none other than British ace Robert Stanford Tuck. These men had become good friends after the war, and they mutually agreed that both sides would be portrayed accurately. This would cause a bit of a row later in the production of the movie, which I'll talk about later. I'd have to go on all day to talk about all of the problems they ran into, so I'll focus primarily on the aircraft. There were no flying Messerschmitts in the world, nor Heinkel 111s to use in the movie, and precious few Hurricanes and Spitfires. Aircraft wranglers were hired to go find what they could. Eventually, about a dozen Spitfires and six Hawker Hurricanes, three of which were in flying condition, were located, but many of the Spitfires were of later design. However, the movie makers, paying much attention to detail, went through great efforts to make them look like the Spitfire Mark I and Mark II that were used during the Battle of Britain. They also found that the Spanish Air Force had a large number of aircraft that were based on German designs. The Casa 2.111 twin-engine bomber was essentially a Spanish version of the German Heinkel 111. The only major external difference was that it was equipped with Hispano-Suiza engines, which gave the engine cowlings a very different profile. They also found out that the Spanish Air Force, which was in the process of converting to jets, were getting rid of their entire inventory of Casa 1112 M1L Mouchon single-seat fighters. This was a Spanish version of the Messerschmitt Bf 109. It was also equipped with Hispano-Suiza engine, so it had a very different cowling profile than the original Messerschmitt, but otherwise it looked just like it. It also had a four-bladed prop instead of a three-bladed prop. Despite problems between Spain and England at the time, the Spanish military was quite interested in helping with the project, so they actually agreed to provide 30 of the bombers along with crews, provided that the movie producers simply paid their expenses. This was a watershed event for the making of the movie. The fighters were a bit of a different story. They were in the process of being mustered out of the service. They were purchased in a lot for roughly $2,500 apiece. The aircraft wrangler then learned that the Spanish Air Force had approximately 30 to 40 airframes that were in the process of being scrapped. He bought them as a lot to use both as spare parts, and in fact, they were able to cobble together a few flying airplanes out of the deal. There was a little bit of a side story on the bid. Apparently, some Spanish locals learned what was going on. They knew the planes were going to be used in a movie. They put in an absurdly high bid on all of the junked airframes in hopes of acquiring them, so that they could then turn around and sell them at an inflated price to the movie producers. Fortunately for the aircraft wranglers, they had failed to fill the paperwork out correctly, and the Battle of Britain movie aircraft wranglers won the bid and got the spare parts. So now they had the German side of the equation. As the fates would have it, four members of the Confederate Air Force, today known as the Commemorate Air Force, had purchased four of the Kassa single-seat fighters to take back to their collection in the United States. They agreed to stay on and use their aircraft for the movie in return for, instead of getting paid, getting their choice of some of the aircraft to take with them when they left. That would be their payment for helping out in the movie. Given that they were proficient in flying World War II era aircraft, the four pilots from the Confederate Air Force did a great deal of the flying for the movie, one of their pilots claiming he was shot down over 100 times during the production of the movie. Many of the scenes with the bombers, especially on the ground, were filmed at Tablada Air Base in Spain. Despite Spain normally having beautiful springs, this particular year they had an unusual amount of foul weather, which complicated filming the movie. Eventually, aircraft were moved over to England, and despite it being 23 years since the end of World War II, the idea of German markings on aircraft, including swastikas on the tail, flying into English airspace still made a great many people uncomfortable. Despite this, the production got underway. In a movie using almost 100 aircraft, inevitably there are going to be some mishaps and accidents. It's simply going to happen. The only fatality in the movie was a Spanish pilot who was killed while ferrying one of the Messerschmitts to England. Reports say that he was off by himself doing aerobatics in the aircraft when it flew into the ground. Prior to shooting in England, 1 minute of silence was held in his honor. Once production was underway at Duxford, everyone was extremely busy. A B-25 Mitchell, called the Psychedelic Monster, that had been modified for air-to-air filming, was used. It was given bright, gaudy colors with stripes all over the aircraft to help other pilots to keep their bearings. Since this was before the day of computer-generated imagery, all the flying scenes had to be filmed air-to-air with real aircraft. One of the things that allowed for some interesting footage was the possession of one of the Bouchons that was manufactured as a trainer with two seats. This is the only one of its type left in the world. Throughout the movie, the technical advisors, including Galland and Tuck, would frequently come to the set to see what was going on. At one point, Stanford Tuck and Galland were allowed to fly the two-seat Spanish copy of the Messerschmitt, and apparently they put on quite the show. At one point during filming, there was a complaint made that the pilots were not flying aggressively enough in the fighter planes. There were concerns about flying such old aircraft too aggressively, but eventually the flying became a bit more aggressive so that it would look good on camera and be more authentic. However, during one scene, one of the Kassa fighter planes flown by a Texan actually did catch fire. The pilot had to make an emergency belly landing, but escaped unharmed, and the aircraft was saved. Apparently, sliding through the dirt field put the fire out. The cost of operating so many aircraft was getting extremely high, and the film kept running over budget, which required additional funding from other sources. Director Guy Hamilton wasn't very concerned about this because he wanted to make sure he had a movie that people would remember. He wanted it to look good, and it did. The two producers, Harry Saltzman and Benjamin Fiz, were always trying to find additional money to keep the movie going. Both of them had a reasonable amount of pull, but they had to pull money from several different sources, and there were times when they were down to their last few days' worth of operating capital when more funding would come in. Despite this, they refused to go cheap or to compromise the quality of the film. The scene with the Germans bombing Duxford was actually filmed at Duxford, and there was an old truss hangar at Duxford that they got permission to set charges off in. Well, apparently there was a little bit of confusion. They thought they had permission to blow the hangar up, whereas a review of the paperwork showed they simply had permission to set off charges in the hangar. Guy Hamilton told his pyrotechnics experts to blow the bloody hangar up. Easier to beg forgiveness than ask permission. The first try didn't go so well, but the second try did. Yes, that is a real hangar really being blown up by foo gas for the movie. The Spanish Heinkel pilots were very professional, which is one of the reasons they were able to get such good formation footage. And it took a lot of nerve to sit there stationary while other pilots came screaming by in fighter planes very close, and they had to get extremely close to look good on camera. The director was constantly calling for the planes to get closer and closer to the camera plane. They managed to do it repeatedly without serious incident. There was one of the Spanish fighters that had a landing gear fold up on landing. This was not uncommon given the design of the aircraft. The Messerschmitt-style landing gear was notoriously unreliable. The aircraft was not able to be used again for the rest of the movie. The stunt coordinator for the movie was Wilson Connie Edwards, and he retained a Mark 9 Spitfire and six of the Bouchons and a P-51 Mustang in lieu of payment. These aircraft were flown and used in movies for some time, but eventually went to storage in Texas. They were finally sold to collectors in 2014. The Stukas represented a particular problem because there were none left, at least none in flying condition. In fact, there were only a handful left in the world. The British were going to allow the movie makers to use one, but once they saw the work that was done to the radio control models, they decided that was a better way to go. So all of the Stukas you see in the movie are radio controlled. The same can be said for all of the other aircraft, especially, of course, when you see them crash. However, they were large scale, well made, and looked very good on camera. After principal shooting with the actors was done, the entire Air Force was moved to the Mediterranean, where hopefully the weather would be better and they could continue filming to get the aerial footage that they needed. And eventually, the movie drew to a close, with no one else being harmed during its production. But a lot of the footage, since it's real aircraft flying in real formations and a real sky, look beautiful. Flying scenes from this motion picture are frequently recycled in other movies. They simply cannot be beat. Many of the aircraft, with the exception of the Heinkels, are still flying. Now, there's one thing about this movie that confused a lot of people, myself included, until I read the book. Some of the characters in the movie are real, and some are not. Sir Laurence Olivier was cast as Sir Hugh Doughty. Trevor Howard was cast as Air Vice Marshal Sir Keith Park, who was in charge of Number 11 Group. Patrick Wymark was cast as Air Vice Marshal Trafford Lee Mallory, who was in charge of Number 12 Group. Now, these three people were real people. The rest of the pilots and characters were composites. One of the main characters was squadron leader, simply referred to as Skipper, played by Robert Shaw. He was very much based on the famous British pilot, Sailor Milan. Ian McShane played Sergeant Pilot Andy Moore. He was there deliberately to represent the fact that many of the British fighter pilots were in fact enlisted men. His counterpart, played by Edward Fox, was Pilot Officer Archie, who was there to represent the lower ranking officers that were fighter pilots during the battle. One other person who made an appearance that was very important was Bill Foxley. Bill Foxley had been a navigator trainee with the Bomber Command in World War II, and he suffered severe burns following a crash. He was cast deliberately to show the real-world effects on some people, even those who survived the battle, to help represent the dangers that they faced. He actually formed a relationship with Susanna York, who in the book made it a point to keep eye contact with him and never look away. She found it a very emotional experience. In fact, playing her character, Section Officer Maggie Harvey, the wife of a fighter pilot, was a very moving experience for her. Being born after the war, she had always seen the Battle of Britain as just a piece of history. But once she met Bill Foxley and got to know some of the other people that actually fought in the battle, and then did some emotionally challenging scenes, the whole thing started to become very real for her. Susanna York's character was cast not only to show the tensions that the war brought to marriages, but also to show the sacrifice that many women made during the Battle of Britain, as well as men. Many of the German characters were based on real people, and others were composites. Heinz Reiss played Hermann Göring, Karl Otto Alberti as General Jeselnik, Dietrich Fraubos as Field Marshal Erhard Milch, Wilfried von Aachen as General Osterkamp, Peter Hager as Field Marshal Albert Kesselring, Wolf Harnisch as General Johannes Fink. These were all real people from the battle. However, when it came to the pilots, many of them were composites. Manfred Redemann played Major Falke. Falke was clearly patterned after the movie's technical advisor, Adolf Galland, known as Dolfo to his friends, right down to the point where he asked Goering for a squadron of Spitfires, which is something that Dolfo actually did. One other thing I found interesting was that in the movie, you're introduced to Falke's younger brother, who, as you notice by his absence later in the movie, is killed during the battle. Generally speaking, all of these characters were well portrayed. The German actors insisted that they not portray caricatures of the actual people, but portray them in a serious and fair manner, and they did. But there was one big flap. In the scene where Goering is leaving, he's furious for having failed to achieve air superiority over England. As his train pulls away, General Osterkamp gives a standard military salute, which was common in the Luftwaffe. But Kesselring gives what has become known as the Nazi salute. It just so happened that Adolf Galland was on the set that day and immediately exploded into anger. He was furious about this because he was adamant that that is not what would have happened. It was a blatant technical inaccuracy. Goering would have received the standard military salute that Luftwaffe officers gave. The so-called Nazi salute was only given in the presence of the Führer by the average military man. The SS used that salute, but they were a separate organization. Guy Hamilton was adamant that he wanted that in the movie to remind people that these were Nazis, and Kesselring was in fact a member of the Nazi Party. But Galland was furious. He insisted that they were starting to turn the movie into a piece of propaganda. Hamilton had him removed from the set, and he flew home to Germany. His friend Stanford Tuck tried to ameliorate the situation to no avail. Eventually, Galland threatened to boycott the movie, have his name removed, and actually speak out against the film prior to its release, which would have hurt sales. The investors just wanted the problem to go away. The producers, Saltzman and Fiz, tried to gloss over the situation, but Galland was intransigent. Eventually, Galland arrived in a screening room with his lawyer, and they showed the scene. He seemed to have softened just a little bit, and once he saw the final cut, he realized it wasn't actually quite as big of a deal as he'd made it out to be. He simply said it's inaccurate and they think it's unnecessary, but okay. So the scene stayed. Once the movie was in the can, so to speak, and started making its rounds to the theater, the budget had ballooned from an original $3 million to $13 million. Now, that doesn't seem like much today, but in 1968, that was huge money. But that's okay. It was a blockbuster hit in 1969 and has what is still to this day some of the finest aerial scenes ever put to film. Thanks to people like retired Group Captain T.G. Hamish Mahaddy, the Confederate Air Force, the Spanish Air Force, Benjamin C. Fiz, Harry Saltzman, and Guy Hamilton, former Battle of Britain pilots Douglas Bader, James Lacy, Robert Stanford Tuck, Adolf Galland, and no less than Hugh Dowding himself, and is so accurate it borders on a historical document. One other side issue that's worthy of note was the rift between the commanders of 11 Group and 12 Group, Trafford Lee Mallory and Keith Park. There was a concern by Park, who was living in New Zealand at the time, that the movie would gloss over this, but it didn't. It did an honest job of portraying the contentiousness between the two men. In fact, in the scene where Park and Mallory are arguing about their relative tactics in front of their boss, Dowding, just outside of camera range was the real Hugh Dowding, sitting in his wheelchair watching. When the scene was over, all of the actors virtually held their breath to look at him for approval or disapproval. Dowding, an extremely reserved individual, simply gave a small smile and a nod to tell them they'd got it right, and the room breathed a collective sigh of relief. So if you ever want to know what it takes to make an excellent movie like this, well, just get yourself 100 vintage warbirds, people to crew them, maintain them, money to operate them, some good screenwriters, some great actors, and tell a story worth telling. What could be simpler? I'm Captain Max. I hope you enjoyed this brief history on the making of the Battle of Britain.